Let's explore the beauty of bedding plants coming up on Gardener's Hotline. Welcome to Gardener's Hotline. I'm your host, Karen Stauderman, a University of Florida Horticulture Extension Agent. Bedding plants are defined as plantings of fast-growing plants into flower beds to create colorful, temporary, seasonal displays during spring, summer, or winter. The plants can be annuals, biennials, or perennials. And some bedding plants are also referred to as patio plants because they are widely used in pots and containers on patios, terraces, decking, and other areas around the house. My guest today is a commercial producer of bedding plants. Let's welcome to the show Bruce Knox of Knox Nursery in Winter Haven, Florida. Hi, Bruce.
Hi, Karen. Thanks for having me.
Oh, thanks for coming to the show. This is a real treat to have you here because you're the expert on bedding plants and annuals.
Thanks for having me. Yes, we started in the business. My parents started the business in 1962, so 52 years we've been at it.
Wow, that's quite a while. Now, is it just you by yourself?
No, my brother also works with me.
Wow. Oh, my gosh, you're a staple here in Central Florida.
Yes, we are. We have grown the business to be one of the top 100 greenhouse growers in the United States.
Wow. Well, Bruce, I'd like to invite our viewers at home to join in our program today, and the number to call in is 1-800-901-9238. Well, let's get started. Tell me, what happens at Knox Nursery and how big is it? How many people do you have working for you?
We have about 100 employees that work at the nursery. Plants are living products, so we're there 365 days a year. And we have a unique product line that we brought technology back from Denmark, and it's a called Easy Pot. It's a paper sleeve, and we basically stuff soil into it. It's like making a link sausage. And then once it's stuffed, we cut it into links and place it in the trays. And then we take plants, whether it be a vegetative or a seed-grown annual, and plant it in the top. And it grows, roots out, and 4 to 6 weeks later, we sell it to a local theme park, hotels, motels, golf course.
Where do you
get
your soil? I mean, is it locally or is it?
We actually bring all of our soil media comes in from Canada. We use a Canadian peat with a perlite blend, and we also incorporate our special blend of time-release fertilizers in our soil media to give us just the right nutrition for our growth cycle.
Okay, and then the seeds. Where do you get your seeds at? Just any seeds?
Well, we import, we buy through brokers who sell seeds that are produced all over the world.
Wow.
Basically, different plants are indigenous to different regions of the world. So we bring them in and then we sow them on a high-speed mechanical seeder. And
how many are seeded at a time?
In a tray, there's 288 cells in a tray. Sometimes they're as small as 512 units per tray or 288, which is what we're looking at now.
Those are small plants.
Yes, 5/8 inch plug. And again, it's only in that stage for anywhere from 3 to 10 weeks and then transplanted into the trays. And here you see the germination chambers where, again, we produce 150 million seedlings a year and we want to have very specific temperature ranges. So it goes
it's
into
warm,
the germ room.
I assume.
Yeah, it's warm or cool depending upon the time of the year. If it's summertime, we were wanting to cool down. And then the product only stays in there for 3 days, just long enough for the seed coat to crack, and then it goes to the greenhouse.
And then you manually hand water it.
Well, we have boom irrigators that irrigate it, and then for spot watering, we do spot water. And you can see that everything is on raised tables, and the tables move through the greenhouse
wow.
On a roller system. And in this greenhouse, we're actually using a system created by University of Florida for using no pesticides on a poinsettia crop. So they use banker plants and predatory mites to kill insects that target poinsettias.
That's fantastic technology. Look at all the different colors that you have here.
Yes, many different plants.
How many different plants do you have?
Over 15,000 different items in our inventory.
And then you ship it off in cargo trucks?
Yes, we ship them in refrigerated trucks if they're going to other young plant, if it's going to a young plant customer, if it's finished, it's going in a straight truck here in the United States. You can see we use, every one of our trays has an RFID label, radio frequency identification, and he's packing it. It's going to go out via Federal Express to our customer who's going to transplant the product and then sell it to maybe a mass merchant or a retail garden center.
How long does it stay on the truck? How many days?
About 2 days.
Okay, they're okay when you pull them out?
Yes, they're perfect.
How cold is the truck? What temperature?
We run our trucks at about 45 degrees in transit.
Wow, that's chilly.
Yes.
Any of them ever freeze on you?
Well, we've had an equipment malfunction and froze a whole load. It was a block of ice in there.
Oh, my gosh.
It froze a million plants.
Oh, makes you want to cry because they're so pretty.
Absolutely.
Now, I know you brought some beautiful plants here in the studio. Let's talk a little bit about some of the plants you have. First of all, what I want to talk about is this beautiful tray here of marigolds. And here's the fantastic label you were talking about, RFID, right?
Yes, radio frequency identification. It allows us not to use a barcode to track the inventory. It emits a radio frequency when it's near a scanning zone, so we know exactly what we have and where it's at in our facility.
Wow, and how big is your facility?
It's about 20 acres.
Wow. So, but it does look like a barcode.
Yes, it's a barcode on the front, but it's a two-ply label, and behind it is the radio frequency computer chip, basically.
Wow, the way of technology. Now, this plant, most of them, if not all of them, look pretty even in size.
Yes, that's the beauty of plug technology, growing things from a plug instead of coming from a open seed tray, which is how they used to be produced.
All right, now how old is this plantlet?
This plant here is about 3 weeks old. And again, it's a self-contained unit. One seed is placed in this cell through the mechanical transplanter. And again, grows for 3 weeks, basically gets a little tiny bud set on it, and then it's ready for transplant. And then we would transplant it into one of these trays.
Now, how many plants are in this tray? Because it's got a lot of holes.
288.
Wow. And is this the smallest that you have?
No, a 512. So there would be 512 wow. cells in the same square foot.
And that's a smaller plant.
It's a smaller plant, about half the size of this.
Wow. And then those get shipped also at that small size.
That's correct.
Wow. Well, let's look at the beautiful color here. Let's start with this end here, these snapdragons.
On the end, we have snapdragons, and as you can see, there's two different heights. So we have a large variety, which is Sonnet. It gets about 18 inches to 2 feet in the landscape. And then its dwarf cousin here is a dwarf snapdragon, that's Snapshot. And it'll only get about 12 to 14 inches in the landscape.
What colors do they all come in?
A whole rainbow. You've got reds, yellows, pinks, some bicolor flowers, whites.
Wow. What's the most popular color of them?
Here in Florida, it seems like red is our most common color. Interestingly enough, in the Northeast United States, white is a very popular
wow.
color.
Wow. Who would have guessed? Why do you think they're white and we're red?
That's a good question, and I don't know the answer
Something
to it.
Something to do with temperature?
It could be.
Okay. Now, do you ever sell those by mixed? Like lots of different colors?
Yes, we do offer mixes. We sell them in solid colors or a mix of all the colors, or we also do themed mixes. So,
what's that mean? What's themed mixes?
Themed to where you get, let's say a salsa mix would have your oranges, reds, yellows, things like that. Watercolors mix, they come in your purples and lavenders and whites.
Wow, that's beautiful. And then I suppose red, white, and blue?
Yes, they can come in red, white, and blue, like petunias. That would be a common mix for that.
Well, let's move on to the next type of color that you have there.
The next one is a viola. What's nice about the violas is it's a very dainty little flower, but it's small, only about 1 inch, and it's of the pansy family, but it's very cold tolerant. But it's also a little bit more warm tolerant as well, so you can plant it a little bit earlier. It'll go all the way through the spring, and then it'll also tolerate some of the warmer conditions.
Will this freeze on us here in Central Florida?
No, pansies and violas will not freeze.
Wow.
Yes.
Can't beat that. And this, I think, is my favorite because it has such detail of the purple. Now, Bruce, how come there's two different colors in it as well? Is this the immature flower?
No, actually, we plant multiple seeds in that pot.
Okay, so you could have up to how many seeds at the same time?
About four different seeds in that pot.
Wow, that's beautiful. And will these get much taller than this?
They'll probably triple in height, approximately double, triple in height.
You know what? I think that we should include more of these flowers in our flower beds, but I don't see too many people doing that these days. Why do you suppose?
Yeah, it's a shame. I don't know if it's how busy everybody is, but there's such a joy in flowers. I love going to work every day and looking out over this ocean of color. And I think it'd be a much better world if everybody was planting flower beds and just enjoying the massive color in their own environment.
Not to mention increasing property value of the beauty of it all.
Absolutely.
Now let's talk a little bit about these other pansies there. This beautiful garnet red and some purple and, of course, this yellow. It's stunning.
The yellow is striking, and at this time of year, these two planted together is just contrasting color that is really very striking. And it really gets down to what the individual consumer wants. Sometimes you want complementary colors and sometimes you want contrasting colors. So, and that's the beauty of flowers is you can do it. There's no wrong answer. You can do it the way you want to do it. What looks good to you?
What are the most common colors in the spring and then the most common colors in the fall? Are there trends?
Well, trends are, again, it's about everybody's individual flavor. Bold colors at this time of year. A lot of red and whites. Talk about contrasting colors. We're coming up to Christmas time. Pretty soon everybody's going to want red and white pansies. That's the primary one. We even sell poinsettias to go in the landscape and plant that next to alyssum, white alyssum, sweet alyssum.
Wow.
So you get the fragrance of the white alyssum and the beauty of the red and white mixed together for the holidays.
It's like a theme park at your own house.
Absolutely.
All right, now let's move on to the next type of plants you have here, petunias.
The next is a petunia, and they come in about 14 different colors. And again, lots of striking, deep colors, reds, purples, pinks, rose, burgundies, just a wide array of colors. Again, a nice cold-tolerant plant. Doesn't really like to be really wet. So if we have a wet winter, it's not the best performing plant, but they do take the cold weather, take freezing temperatures.
And so these will mostly, we'll plant them in the fall and in the winter, and then by spring, we'll pull them out and replace them with a warm temperatured plant?
Correct. Basically, we hope to get 4 months out of an annual. So 3 to 4 months is the target window for any annual. And then you plant it now, you pull it out in March, and then you come back in with your spring annual. So that would be things like begonias, marigolds, things like that.
Is there a lot of deadheading on those petunias?
No, they are pretty much self-cleaning.
Wow. Because there used to be the varieties where you always have to go out there and just deadhead and take off the dead blossoms off.
Yes, they pretty much just dry up and fall off.
And beautiful intensity of color.
Yes.
Okay, now we also have what looks like dianthus or carnation?
Yeah, it's a dianthus. It's a family of carnation or sweet William. It also is a cool weather, cool season plant. It can also take some warmer temperatures, just not the heat of the summer. Again, really striking colors. It comes in these bicolors that you see here. And this is a strawberry and a raspberry.
Wow.
So really nice colors.
And you can, of course, pair them together in the landscape as well. What other colors do they come in?
They come in reds, whites, pinks, a blueberry color.
Wow.
So a wider range.
You name them according to fruits.
Yes, that's funny how the breeders, I always wonder what the breeders are thinking when they name some things.
Where do those seeds come from internationally?
Japan, I think.
Oh, really? Carnations come from Japan?
Yes.
Okay. What percent of them come from Europe and Japan and here?
Europe is relatively small, but Gerber has come out of Denmark.
Oh.
That's unique there, but a lot of flower seeds come out of Central America. Impatiens.
Are these certified seeds, meaning disease-free?
No, they're not disease-free, but they are tested for disease that could be on the seed themselves.
I see. Okay. All right. Now we move on to
Moving on to warm weather plants. Warmer. So this is a melampodium. It's a very small yellow flower. Again, more heat tolerant and, again, a real clean, crisp yellow that really would contrast very nicely with something red next to it, or even that raspberry dianthus in front of it.
Well, that'd be a great combination. We've got Mary from Orlando on the phone. Hi, Mary. Welcome to the program. What's your question today for Bruce?
Yeah, I guess it's a two-part question. I want to know when it would be the right time to clip the flowers off to promote more floral growth, or just leave it alone and let it die off by itself, you know.
A good time would be once you start seeing a seed pod start to form. So the flower will decline, and you can just pinch it off at that point.
Can you collect the seed?
It would be a good thing.
Yeah, so when she's pruning them off, though, does that stimulate more blooms, or can you just clip it off and then it starts to go back down?
Well, the plant is putting energy into that dying flower, trying to save it or reproduce. So it's trying to push out that seed pod for reproduction. So clipping it off will put more energy back into the plant and allow more flowers to come.
Okay, so it is best to take them up and pull them out.
Yes.
We have Howard from Ocala. Hi, Howard. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
Well, hello. My question is, what annuals would be suitable for death shade for this time of year and for early spring?
So he's talking about fall and spring, something for dense shade. What do you recommend?
Dense shade is that's a tough one here in Florida. We used to have impatiens that did very well. It was a staple for many years, and unfortunately they had a disease attack the strain, basically. So what we would recommend, begonias do extremely well, and there is a hybrid begonia called dragon wing begonias, and it's a nice bright green foliage with red flowers. So very good. That's what we would recommend.
But how many hours of sunlight do you recommend for that one? Because sometimes they need some sunlight.
They do need some filtered sun, but if it was under a oak tree hammock or something like that, it would be sufficient.
That's great, because then you have color in those shaded areas.
Absolutely. It brightens it up.
Brightens it up, yeah. It helps scary places look more prettier. All right, so now let's move on to the begonias here.
Yes, regular begonias. This is a regular fibrous begonia. They come in reds, pinks, whites, and rose colors. It's really a staple of spring and fall planting. So,
why is that? Because they're hard to kill and easy to grow?
They're easy to grow and hard to kill. That's exactly right. Just coming out of winter, because they can't take freezing temperatures, but they don't like it really hot either.
Okay, so you have to cover these when we have cold weather.
Exactly. It would have to be covered.
I think I like this pink color right here. It's such an intensity of color that I was holding up earlier in the program, and you know, just teamed with them all. I love the red of the foliage, and then you have this other color, which is mostly green. Will this eventually turn red?
If it was planted in full sun, this green would bronze to look something like that, but just not quite as dark of a chocolate color.
So sun stimulates the red pigment.
That's correct.
Okay, well, is the opposite true? If you put them in shade, it'll go back to green?
It'll be more green under heavy shade conditions.
I didn't
conditions.
Know that. Okay, but I yes. see a lot of people use these in indoor plants, as house plants. What color would the foliage take off? Does that depend upon the light intensity?
It depends on the light that it is getting.
Oh, wow, I didn't know that. That's a fact I didn't know. You just taught me something new today.
An interesting fun fact about begonias, though, is that the seeds are so small. The seed package says, do not sneeze. There's 2 million seeds to an ounce.
Oh, my gosh.
So they're tiny, tiny, tiny.
That is tiny. There's profits right there in a little teaspoon.
Absolutely.
All right. Now let's look at this celosia, right?
Yes, a celosia. It comes in two different forms, a coxcomb type, or this is a feather plume type. And it's a good warm weather plant. It will reseed itself, so it as long as the beds aren't heavily mulched, they'll come back year after year.
And a coxcomb is literally like a rooster comb of the comb on his head.
Yes, or also known as a brain coleus as well, because it kind of resembles a brain
as
well.
Oh, yeah, big brain. I love those plants, and they're great for warm weather, right?
Yes, fantastic.
So this flat is mostly warmer weather.
That is correct, warm weather
plant.
And
the intensity of color, oh, my.
Well, again, if you look at the contrasting colors of that red celosia and that yellow marigold, again, it's a stark contrast, but really beautiful.
Well, let's talk about the famous standbys of the marigolds.
Yeah, talk about a staple plant. Marigolds are a staple in our landscape. Come in two different forms, a French type and an African type. The Africans have these much larger crested flowers than what the French do.
And they're great for nematode prevention. I think it's the French variety is what you use best for nematode control, nature's way.
That's correct. And you can also plant them around your vegetable garden to keep pests out.
Yes, yeah, slugs especially.
Especially slugs.
We've got Karen from Orlando on the line. Hi, Karen. What's your question for Bruce today?
Hi. I'm actually from Palm Coast, which is in Central Florida. And my home, the front yard, I'm looking for something colorful like a staple plant, but I have a large pine tree and full sun. What could you recommend?
Well, it's going to get a lot of sunlight with that pine tree. So basically anything that is will take more light. So at this time of year, being in Palm Coast, your snapdragons, pansies, violas, petunias, they're all good selections.
And that selection's for fall. We're in the fall season now.
Exactly.
What about in the spring? What do you recommend her going into the hot summer?
Spring, I would go with begonias, marigolds, staple plants. The celosia would work great also. And then in the deep part of summer where it's really hot and rainy, pentas are great selections. And your vegetative coleuses, all the different colors you get in the leaves.
Right. Always exciting. Oh, we've got John from Mount Dora. Hi, John. Welcome to the program. What's your question?
Hi. How are you doing?
Hi.
My question is, I have a problem with gardenias. I can't keep them alive. The leaves are always turning yellow and falling, and then they die. And I also, when I lived down in South Florida, I was able to get a hybrid of the gardenias, which when they bloomed, they were a canary yellow. And I'm just wondering if there's any around this area or where I can, they were beautiful and I hated to move away and not dig them up or take them with me, but I'm wondering if there is a place where I can get the hybrid, the yellow gardenias.
Well, John, the problem with the gardenias is you have to get them grafted. When you grow them, certain varieties grown straight into our soil without being grafted on diseased free rootstock and tolerant to our nematodes is if they don't get grafted, they will die very quickly. And you'll start to see the yellowing, the leaves falling. So you have to make sure you go to a Florida nursery that tells you that it is definitely grafted on disease-resistant rootstock against nematodes. You're going to pay more for it, but that's the only way that they'll survive here in Central Florida because the nematodes are so bad. Now, the yellow variety you're talking about, you'll probably have to go online or get a hold of some of the plant outlets and take a look that way, or contact your local nursery. They might be able to tell you which variety it is. But one thing you must not do is do not plant a gardenia in the same spot that the previous one was planted in. Because if it dies at that spot and a new one gets planted in there, then it will die just twice as fast because the diseases go into it. So we've got another caller on the line, probably our last caller for the show today. Hi, caller. Welcome to the program. What's your question for Bruce today?
Oh, hey, Karen. I love your show. I watch it all the time. My question for today was, what flowers grow so well in shade?
Shade, we would recommend begonias are a great item. Also, your coleus is another good item. But ipomea, an ornamental sweet potato, also does extremely well in shade, and it gives you a vibrant a yellow color, a chartreuse color.
Oh, yeah, that's like neon yellow, and it's like the latest thing. And they come in bronzes, too.
Yeah, they come in bronzes,
reds. Do you guys
reds.
Know that?
Yes, we do.
Oh, man, that's beautiful, that color. Okay, Bruce, now, while I've got you here, let me ask you a brief question. As succulent as these leaves are, do they need more water than the rest because they are so watery?
Actually, they probably need a little less water. One of the things that can happen with a begonia, if you get a little sun shower, like we're coming into summer and you get a sun shower and the sun pops back out, basically a begonia leaf is mostly made of water, about 85% water. So a leaf droplet magnifies onto that leaf and then causes an injury, and then you'll get a secondary fungus come in and wipe out the plant.
Oh, and then let's recommend them not watering from overhead, but watering them from underneath to prevent disease problems?
Yes, that's fantastic.
So more like drips or a little spot spitters underneath.
Mm-hmm. That would be
keep
excellent.
The diseases down. Any special technique on fertilizer that you recommend? Any special liquid or slow release?
Well, any of your liquid fertilizer sold at your local garden center is excellent, but we like controlled release fertilizers. A 3-month release curve will get you through the growing cycle of these annuals.
And you know what's so neat is you can start off with a theme in one season and turn around and change the theme to something else. You never get tired of changing it up, and you can never make mistakes at flowers.
That's absolutely correct. Color the world, and you can make it however you like it. You can do a hodgepodge like is being done in the villages, or you can make color blocks, basically where you have a contrasting color planted in mass.
And you can warm it up by the warm colors and cool it down by the cooler colors of the palette.
Exactly right.
Oh, that's terrific. Oh, I'm so glad that you came to the program today. We've learned so much about plants and annuals and how to take care of them. And any final thoughts that you'd like to add?
No, plant more flowers. That's my final thought, whether it be in containers for your porch, front door, or flower beds.
Well, that's all the time that we have today, and I hope you've learned a little more about bedding plants. I'd like to thank my guest, Bruce Knox from Knox Nursery, and thank you for joining in today's program. If you have any more questions, please feel free to email me at wdsc@daytonastate.edu. See you again next week on Gardener's Hotline.